Welcome to KU Padasala. My name is Chad A. Haag. I'm an author and former teacher from the United States of America, and I'm very excited today to have the opportunity to discuss with you the very important topic of German for reading knowledge. In this intensive course, which makes no presupposition that you have studied the language before, we will give you the skills to move from perhaps being completely new to the German language to having a very high level of comprehension, not only your skills of reading German, but also your ability to write the language, to speak it, and your knowledge of vocabulary and grammar. All of that we will work on over the course of these 10 units. But one might begin with the perfectly legitimate question, why have a course emphasizing German for reading knowledge in particular? And the short answer to that is that there's simply so much massively important academic literature and scholarship that was originally written in the German language. This was because Germany had arguably the single best university system in the history of the world over 100 years ago. So even if you're coming from a background which is not foreign language, quote-unquote, per se, but is rather something like a philosophy, well, having mastery over the literary conventions of the German language will prove enormously useful in allowing you to gain access to thinkers like Kant, Hegel, Schopenhauer, Nietzsche, Heidegger, and many others in the original language. But it's not just philosophy, also the origins of psychology, psychoanalytic thinkers like Sigmund Freud, or the analytic psychology of Carl Jung, as well as the theory of history from figures like Oswald Spengler, the sociology of Weber and Habermas, along with the New Testament scholarship of figures like Bultmann. All of that you'll be able to read after completing this course. But of course, there is the properly literary tradition of the German language, the novels of Mann, Kafka, and Jung, as well as the poetry of Holderlin, Goethe, and Trakl. But another question one might ask before beginning the course is whether German is quote-unquote easier to learn if you already speak English than many of the other languages. I guess what this question is really trying to ask is whether German is closer to English than the other European languages. And the answer to that question is a little bit complicated because when you talk about the English language, there might be several different languages really which you're referring to. It is true, for example, that the language called Old English, which was spoken in the early medieval era, what is largely called the Dark Ages, that was a fully Germanic language, which used many of the same grammatical conventions which continue to be used in modern German, but which fell out of use over the centuries, largely due to the political fact of the influence of another language on English. That language was French. In the 11th century AD, with the Norman invasion, there was a strange sociological dichotomy established within what is today called England, in which a nobility ruled the island but spoke French, while the peasants and laborers continued to speak this older Germanic language which had been spoken there for centuries. And this resulted in a very strange sense we continue to have today as speakers of modern English, that there's usually two different words for the same concept, but we realize that one of the words is to be used in more everyday and informal contexts, while the other is to be used in more formal, sophisticated, or learned contexts. You may be surprised to know that the more everyday word is typically of Germanic origin, while the more sophisticated word is typically of French origin. We'll demonstrate this now with a little game, in which you'll see on the screen four different columns, one containing a German word, another containing a French word of the same meaning, and two columns, one for the English cognate of each. I'll go ahead and complete the first row for you, and then ask you to fill in the others yourself. Now, the German word Hand is quite obviously a cognate of the English word hand, and you might think that's the only word that we have in English to talk about a hand, but you might be surprised to know that we actually do make references to the hand with the French word main, which seems to be completely unrelated. It's just that we realize that these references to the hand are to be used in, once again, more formal, sophisticated, or legalistic contexts. For example, work which is done by hand and is therefore understood to be very difficult labor is something that we don't call handual labor, even though that's literally what it is. Rather, we call it manual labor, because the French word main is to be used in more formal contexts, whereas the Germanic word hand is something that we use in more everyday contexts. Now, I'll go ahead and show you a few more rows. I'd like you to fill these in, and then we'll meet back after going through all of these to compare our answers. The next row contains the German word Schaf, which is a cognate of the English word sheep. But the French word mouton actually does have a cognate in English, which once again reflects the sociological distinction between the Germanic-speaking peasant and the French-speaking nobility. The next line, we find the German word Mann, which is obviously a cognate of the English word man, but you may be surprised to know that there are cognates dealing with the concept of man for the French word l'homme. And by the way, because of the peculiarities of French pronunciation, I will use the definite article le before those words that begin with a vowel sound. It simply makes it easier to pronounce, but this word is spelled H-O-M-M-E. In the next line, we see the German word Tag, which is a cognate of the English word day, but the French word jour also has a cognate in the English language, which I'd like to challenge you to try to guess. The German word Gott is obviously a cognate of the English word God, but the French word Dieu also has several cognates in English, which I challenge you to try to guess. The German word Himmel is obviously a cognate of the English word heaven, both begin with a h sound, but the French word ciel also has several cognates. Now, the next row represents something of a transition between two different concepts which we're going to study here, in that here we have the strange situation in which the French word l'esprit is kind of more broadly encompassing, and the Germanic word Geist is kind of more restricted in its meaning, even though in German and French these mean the same thing. So I've provided the English cognate Ghost for the German word Geist, but I challenge you to think of the English cognates for the French word l'esprit. Finally, in the last two columns, we're going to do things a little bit differently. Here, I'm actually going to provide you the English cognate of the French words, and I challenge you to try to think of the English cognates of the Germanic words. But this is, once again, a case of what is called semantic specialization, in which, over time, the meaning of the word came to be more restricted to the point that it seems to be a totally different concept. So these are, once again, the most challenging words on this slide, but I'll ask you to find... For the French word l'animal, we have the English word animal. For the German word, we have Tier. I challenge you to find the English cognate for that word. And finally, for the French word mourir, we have the English cognates mortuary and mortician. And we have the German word sterben. So once again, the last two lines, we have the German word Tier and the German word sterben. I ask you to try to find the cognates. Go ahead, pause the tape, fill in all of the blanks, and we'll meet back in just a moment to compare answers. All right, so if we begin with the second line, we find that the German word Schaf is a cognate of the English word sheep, and this would make sense because sheep have always been so important to the agriculture of the British Isles that it would make sense that this would be a very old word, which reflects some of the grammatical conventions that predate the invasion of the French-speaking Normans. You may have noticed that sheep has different pluralization rules than the average word in the English language, in that you don't just add an S to make it from sheep to sheeps. Nor, however, do you use the Germanic-ish pluralization convention used in archaic words like, say, brethren. If you read the King James translation of the Bible, you'll notice that brothers are referred to as brethren in much the same way that the plural of child is not child, but rather children. And, of course, the animal which was present at the nativity scene of Jesus is not in the plural oxes, but rather oxen. And sociologists or linguists have noted that it's precisely because the nativity story has been a central part of the religious tradition of the West for so many centuries that you still have that form of the word oxen preferred rather than the more modernized version oxes. But with sheep, we have a different case entirely. The plural of sheep is simply sheep. And that's a very different rule, which tells us that this word is very old and certainly of Germanic origin. But with mouton, the French word, we really do have a word referring quite literally to sheep. It's just that mouton is reflecting a very different attitude towards the concept of a sheep, no longer thinking of it as a living animal, which has to be fed daily, which has to be given water, which has to be protected from wolves, but rather mouton as the cognate of the English word mutton. And mutton is simply food on a plate. So we have an understanding that the sociological difference reflected here is the difference between the person who has to deal with the sheep as livestock, which is a peasant, which is somebody of a quote-unquote low status within the medieval world, and therefore a speaker of a Germanic language, while the person who gets to enjoy the luxury of eating mutton as meat on a plate is somebody of privilege. This is a French-speaking noble, and we find this with many other farm animals to the present day. You may wonder why in the English language the word for the animal and the word for the meat are so different from one another. You have the word swine, for example, is as the older word referring to a pig as a living animal, but both in French and English, pork is the word for the meat. You have a cow as the living livestock in a field, but the meat from a cow is beef, just as in French, it's bœuf. A chicken, or more archaically, a hen, is the animal that you have to feed daily, etc. You collect eggs from if you're actually farming. But poultry is kind of the culinary arts term for the meat, because poulet is the French word for a chicken. Now move on to the third line. We find the German word Mann, and obviously the English cognate is man, but we make certain references to the concept of man in, say, legalistic terminology, which can't use that word because of this tacit understanding that the French word is more appropriate for that context. If you think about the legal term for killing a man, it might seem logical to call that manicide, but that's not what we say. Instead, we have to call it homicide, because the French word is starting with an H, which is silent within the French pronunciation, but is still written. The next word, German Tag and English Day, might seem to be the only words to talk about what happens on a daily basis within English, but once again, in more formal context, we realize we have to use the French word jour. And a great example of this is the newspaper, which comes to your house every day, is called a journal, because every jour, it shows up on your doorstep. Similarly, a book which somebody might write their thoughts in on a daily basis is called a journal. It's not called a day-old or something like that. We know we have to use the French word jour. The German word Gott is obviously a cognate of the English word God, but the French word Dieu, we do have more formal words for God, like, say, deities. Okay, if we're talking in a scholarly sense about the variety of gods in the ancient Greek religion, we call those deities, because we're speaking, once again, in a more formal register. Arguably, when we talk about the divine, we're talking about the godly, but we're trying to sound more formal. The German word Himmel and the English cognate heaven are to be contrasted maybe with the French word ciel in terms of morphology, but really they have the same meaning, in that when we're talking about Himmel or ciel, we're not only talking about the heaven where God, the angels, and the saints and good souls live within, say, the Christian religion, we're also talking about the heavens in the sense of the stuff above your head, which is, in one sense, the sky, which may be surprised to know that the ceiling above your head also is a cognate of the French word ciel, for heaven. If we speak in more learned terms about things which are heavenly, we'll also call them celestial. It was truly a celestial experience. Okay, we know that that's the more sophisticated term because the French word is ciel. Now we have a strange case in this third region of the slide in which we see that the German word Geist is similar to the English word ghost, which refers to a certain kind of spirit. But here it's the French word l'esprit, which is closer to the actual English word for what it's trying to talk about, which is a spirit in general. Now, a spirit in general may be good, it may be bad, it may have been in a human body at one point, or it may just be something like a pagan god that never had a human life. Spirit is a very general term, which is to be contrasted with ghost, which only refers to the kind of spirit which once inhabited a human body during its life, but for some reason is not able to move from this world to the afterlife, because in the case of the Shakespearean play Hamlet, Hamlet's father has some unfinished business in this earth. He has to tell his son Hamlet that he was murdered by his brother, and he has to ask him to take revenge. So because something is unresolved, that ghost remains on the earth and causes trouble for people because it cannot join the other souls within heaven or hell. So here we have a strange sense in which it's not that the French word is necessarily more scholarly or formal, it's rather that it's more general in its meaning, whereas the Germanic word ghost came to be more restricted. This is what linguists call a case of semantic specialization. Now the most challenging words on this slide by far were the last two lines, which we will cover now. The general word for an animal in the English language is, of course, a cognate of the French word l'animal, but the German word for all animals animals, tir is something we do have a cognate for in English. It's just the word deer. Now, you might think of a deer today as applying only to one species of animal. They certainly do live in the forest, and they have the big antlers. Bambi is a fictional example of deer in that sense. But you might be surprised to know that originally the word deer within English referred to many more animals than just that. In fact, it was kind of a generic word for animals, but specifically wild animals, in the sense that livestock living on your farm, like the pigs and cows and chickens which you tend on a daily basis, those weren't really deer, because there's an understanding that deer are those animals which live beyond the limits of the farm, beyond the limits of the village, and that place was wild, because in German, the forest is Wald, or W-A-L-D. This is a etymological relation between the wild and the forest, which is noticeable not only in Germanic languages, but even in the Romance languages. In the Italian language, Dante opens the Divine Comedy in Canto 1, talking about being in la selva oscura, which is the dark forest. But he makes reference to animals which are wild, in the Italian sense of being selvaggia, because he's trying to draw our attention to an etymological relation between la selva, or the forest, and that which lives in it, which is selvaggia. So too, in English, when we talk about something being wild, we are tacitly making reference to the German notion of a forest, spelled W-A-L-D. So what we have here is once again a case of semantic specialization. Over time, the word tier came to refer just to one specific kind of animal. We find something very similar in the last example on this slide, in which the French word mourir is maybe not exactly the same as our generic word for dying, which begins with a D, but it does apply to the general notion of death in formal contexts. A mortuary is the building where the dead are placed. A mortician is somebody who professionally works on dead bodies, determines the cause of death, etc. Now, the German word sterben actually does have a cognate with an English word related to death. It's just one which has come to be specialized over time to the point that most people don't automatically associate it with death, but rather with hunger. This is the word starve. Now, you might be surprised to know that the word starve, even as late as, say, the 1960s, it did not always refer to hunger, although it did refer to a process of dying of something. There were certain regional dialects within England in which saying that somebody was starving made a reference to them freezing to death. Somebody did not have enough firewood to get through winter, and the result of that would be starvation, but in the precise sense of freezing rather than dying of hunger. This shows you that starve really came from a more general sense of dying, the Germanic word sterben, and over time came to refer to a smaller class of reference. So with this game completed, we can now move on to the first lesson.